invite you to think of a time in your own life when you felt lost. Whether it was when you were going through a difficult time of uncertainty, time of change, or a time when you were actually literally lost. Call up some of those memories for yourself. And as you do that, I'm going to tell a story about a time when I was lost. When I was little, I was probably in elementary school, my mom and sisters and I went to the state fair, and we parked in one of those lots across 690, those dirt lots. And they probably look exactly the same now as they did then, like no lights. And when you park your car, you're parking in the back row, because that's the back row then, and then things change. Anyway, we couldn't find the car. It was late, and we didn't have a flashlight, there was no lights, and we're trying to find a teeny little Subaru. So my mom brought us to stand with the state troopers. Well, another state trooper went out with her with a flashlight to look for the little Subaru. And as we were with the state troopers, I was with my little sister, Sarah, who never said anything to anyone. She's real quiet. And the state trooper said, "Hey girls, would you like some pop?" Because you know, New York State Fair, we're all called so many different things because we're culturally diverse in the state. And so he said, "Would you like some pop?" And my sister said, "No!" Finally, the cop went around the car. I was like, "Sarah, why did you say no? I wanted soda, free soda." And she goes, "He was offering us drugs." She pulled a full Nancy Reagan on him. We ended up buying the car, had no extra soda. I'm thinking a lot this week about feeling lost, reading about the story of Mary and Joseph, who had come to a time in their life that was normally pretty prescribed by culture. This whole period of betrothal was a legal agreement. We're not talking like down on one knee, diamond ring with six crowns or four. When's the date? I mean, we're not talking about that. And this was a legal agreement between two families, two people. So they were legally bonded to each other, but they were not yet married, so they weren't living with each other yet. So Mary finds herself pregnant in a quite unconventional way, let's just say. And the line in scripture said, her husband Joseph, being a righteous man and unwilling to expose her to public disgrace, planned to dismiss her quietly. The righteous man dismissed her quietly. I think the jury's still out on that one. But that was supposed to be him trying to do the right thing in this situation where they both seemed pretty lost and they weren't sure what the right thing was to do. And then an angel appeared to Joseph in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you are to name him Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins." So even though Mary and Joseph were on quite uncharted territory, they were not lost because God's got this. God came to Joseph in a dream and said, "I know you've never been on this exact path before, in fact, no one has, but I'm here with you and you don't need to be afraid." So I wanted to tell you a story about a time recently when I felt lost, and this was a kind of a metaphorical lostness. It was during the consecration of our new bishop. It got to the time of communion, and you know we're real used to doing communion in our church for like 100 or so people. We've got that down pat all around. But there at the Holiday Inn, when there's like 700 people, there's like 10 different stations that people could go to. It's kind of quite a complex operation. And I have to tell you, things were not going according to plan. Or maybe there was no plan. I don't know. But things were a little mucked up. And I sat back down, and one of the leaders of the liturgy came up to me and several other priests and said, "Grab a carafe of wine and go around."
there. No one was there. No one was in line. They had a basket of bread like this big, two chalices completely full of wine. I came up, you don't need more wine, do you? No, but we haven't had anyone come to get our communion, and we haven't even received communion ourselves. Oh, okay. Let me just do my body of Christ, body of Christ, body of Christ, take care of that. And then I'm walking around with a carafe of wine. No one needs extra wine. And there's like five of us now in carafes walking around. And I decided at one point that I'm just going to try to look important. I'm just walking around with my carafe. And I'm kind of getting fired up a little bit in my head. Here's my inner dialogue. What the heck has happened? I cannot believe that we have the presiding bishop and all these bishops from all these other places in the Episcopal Church, and they're seeing us getting this whole communion thing wrong. I mean, whose job was it? I mean, Jerry, oh my gosh, like, whose job, whose fault is this? Oh my goodness. And I'm getting a little torqued up in my head. And then I feel God kind of tap me on the shoulder, metaphorically, thankfully, because otherwise, white hell, crap wine. Right? God metaphorically taps me on the shoulder and says, Carrie, look around you. We are all together in this room. No one's leaving. No one's actually getting lost here. And there is enough for everybody to be fed. So even though we had some communion stations with nobody there, and a couple poor celiacs went wandering around wondering where the gluten-free stations were, and some all crowded with people, the fact was that we were all in that room. No one was actually going to get lost or hurt. And there was enough to feed everyone. That was my voice of the Lord that I heard saying, don't worry, Carrie. This is uncharted territory. Things aren't going according to plan. But I'm here, and I got this. You're not going to get lost. So there's a metaphor for this. This is a labyrinth. It looks a little like a maze, doesn't it? Looks like a maze you'd find like on a children's menu or in like one of those puzzle books. But this is different. A maze is where you start off, and when you're drawing your line, you can find places where the line can't go anymore. Your path is blocked. You've made a mistake. You need to start over again. Mazes have tricks. They lead you down corridors that have no ending, or they only have endings. Mazes are tricky. But a labyrinth is not tricky. A labyrinth has one path in and one path out. You cannot get lost. You cannot make a mistake. And if you're following the path, you can see that as you're moving forward, step by step, inch by inch, sometimes the path leads us close to the center, and sometimes the path leads us farther away. But we're always moving forward, even though sometimes we're closer and sometimes we're farther away. Now, mathematically minded people can see the pattern, the math pattern in this, and probably wouldn't be surprised if it twists and turns. But normal people, you know, who don't have that special gift, find that we don't know how far we have to go on the labyrinth before we're at the center or before we're at the end. We can just take each turn as it comes. And sometimes we find ourselves near the center. Sometimes we find ourselves toward the outside. But on the labyrinth, we can never get lost because we're always right here. No matter where we are on the path, we're not lost, because we're right here. And there's no mistakes to make. So I borrowed this labyrinth from my mother. This is what happens when your mom's a priest. I bought this for Christmas for her one year, because I know what priests like. And now I borrow it back from her when that's done. So they also have labyrinths that go on the floor. And so they have some that are so big, it takes up like this whole pew area. And people can physically walk the labyrinth as a spiritual practice, as a metaphor for life. So they have one that belongs to Habit, which is a youth retreat. It happened to be at my mother's church, and she rolled it out and let the kids at the Montessori school that meets in her church building walk the labyrinth. And she gave them the whole instruction. I'm sure on some kind of kid level, she's telling them, you follow the path, there's no wrong turns, you can't get lost, go at your own pace, all that stuff. She said that of those kiddos, one girl, one, stayed on the path, made it to the center, and made it out just because she wanted to prove that she could. Other kids got out of the labyrinth and skipped around, and some stopped and talked with each other. Some wanted to know what they'd get if they made it to the center. A couple of boys apparently were rolling on it in a labyrinthal wrestling match. But even though things were not going according to plan, they were not lost, and they were fine. And so pulling all of this together, I invite you to think of a time when you felt lost, or in transition, or in a place where you didn't expect yourself to be. And maybe that's a time in your life where you were grieving, where you had a job change or a life change. Maybe it's a time in the church when we're experiencing change. Maybe it's a time in our nation when we're experiencing change. Sometimes we feel lost, and we desperately want to get it right. We're not exactly sure what it'll look like. But what we are sure of is that there's no way for us to get lost, because there are no boundaries for God. There's nowhere we can go that is outside the presence of God. There's only the presence of God. And so as we journey on the labyrinth, sometimes we'll find ourselves close to the center, sometimes we'll find ourselves farther away, but we are not lost, because God is here, saying, fear not. There may be people who stop on the road to chat. There may be ones who just roll all over the mat. Maybe people who go backwards. There's no such thing as being lost, because it's all in God's hands. There once was a dad and a little boy who went shopping around this time of year at the local mall. Went to go buy some presents for the mom. And as they were in the mall, it had started snowing a lot. And they came outside, and all the cars were covered with snow. You couldn't even see the lines in the parking lot anymore. They walked up and down the road, just kind of silently, holding hands, the little boy's mittened hands and the dad's big, strong, warm hands. And they went up and down the roads looking for their car, beeping every once in a while, hoping to get a little clue. And finally, after a while, the dad just stopped and looked at his kid and said, "Sorry, buddy, I think we're lost." The kid said, "I'm not lost. I'm with you." No matter where we are, there's nowhere we can go that is outside of God's presence and God's grace. And we can know that even when we feel lost, we are held by the hand of God.